members of the media, pleased as usual to see you all, and also good afternoon to the wider listening public of Trinidad and Tobago. I am here today, post-cabinet, to address what is probably the most topical issue circulating right now, which is the issue of GATE. You all would have heard of a special cabinet meeting yesterday where the cabinet took decisions with respect to how the GATE program will be conducted going forward. And we then had the Minister of Education come immediately and address the media and the wider public with respect to those cabinet decisions. So I am here to address and to give some more meat to the skeleton about the whole issue of GATE and the decisions that have now been taken by the Cabinet of Trinidad and Tobago. And I'd like to first of all start off by giving us some sort of contextual understanding and background of a number of issues. The first is government GATE came into being in 2004, and that was a decision of the then PNM government and administration in the year 2004. When the government took a decision to move away from what the former administration, the former UNC administration had, and you would recall a dollar-for-dollar program, which was 50% contribution by the state, 50% contribution by the person who is attempting to be educated. So in 2004, a PNM administration introduced this concept of GATE with some means testing and contribution at a time where oil prices, and our economy is based on hydrocarbons, oil and gas, were at a much higher rate than they are currently. In 2005, again based on the high then prices of oil and gas, the government of the day, again a PNM government, took a decision to go 100% of the funding of the GATE program. And it has been evolving since then. Fast forward now to coming into office in 2015, and now a decision that was made on the 3rd of August, 2016. What I'd like us to understand now is what we've met as a government coming into play. You've heard us say, and really through the Minister of Finance as well as the Honorable Prime Minister, on a number of occasions, our economic circumstances in Trinidad and Tobago as a government are vastly, vastly different and changed. From oil prices, which were high as $100 to $120 a barrel, dropping to as low as $28 a barrel, and recently hovering in the $40 range, it means that there has been a drop in government revenue. And I think the best way to try and explain this to the public is to use the example of if you are earning $1,000 a week and you had run up your weekly expenses to $900, and overnight your income dropped by 60 to 70%, which is what we are facing as a country with the drop in oil prices. It means that your $1,000 a week has now dropped to $300 or $400 a week with a continued expenditure of $900. So the question immediately becomes, as a responsible government, how do you bridge that gap? And one of the areas you all would have heard the government bridging the gap on is the cutting of expenditure across the board and trying to manage things as tightly as possible. One of the issues that came up for government review very early in its term was the issue of GATE. And I think everyone in the country would accept that there was a need for a review of the GATE system. We had been hearing stories about it being a runaway horse. And what the government did was start by mandating the Minister of Education early in our term to hold public consultations on the whole educational process. The Minister of Education dutifully performed his consultations, one in the north, one in the south, and one in Tobago. And at that stage began an analysis of what was taking place in our educational system. The government then in March of this year, as a cabinet, took a decision to appoint a very specialized, experienced, and expert task force to look specifically at this program, which we know as GATE. That task force was then presented with its instruments in April and began its work. In that task force work, it is important to note that they held a number of consultations with stakeholders throughout this education process, including students and others who would be affected by the whole any decision to be made with respect to GATE. The task force presented its report to the Minister of Education on the 1st of July. And in very, very short time frame, i.e. within the space of a month, the Cabinet of Trinidad and Tobago met after having given very careful consideration to the report presented by the task force, which had a number of recommendations. And yesterday, we took decisions as to how the GATE program would be dealt with going forward. The Cabinet has been very responsible because we accept that we are very close and actually upon the next academic year, which would be the academic year of 2016-2017. So one of the first decisions we had to take is recognizing the anxiety of students, parents, families, other users of GATE as to what was going to be happening with them, and to give some lead time and to grandfather it as best as we can to implement the decisions that we took. The decisions we took were based on a desire to cut out wastage, corruption, but also mindful of the continued benefits of the GATE policy, which are to provide tertiary education to our citizens of Trinidad and Tobago in as affordable a manner as possible. But with the context that I've just taken some time to outline, which is we are in very different and changed financial circumstances, where everyone would accept when your revenue drops by 60 to 70% overnight, you have to take certain decisions and hard decisions as to how you manage your finances. And it is our feeling, and certainly the feedback that we've been getting from the public, from students, etc., is that the decisions we have taken are very mature, responsible decisions with consideration for those who are the end users of the GATE program. I'd like to point out at this stage that nowhere else in English-speaking Caribbean is there any other state that provides free tertiary education to the extent that this government does. Barbados was the only other one that provides it. And with their change in circumstances in 2014, the government of Barbados took a decision to immediately cut all funding. This government has not done any such thing. Not only are we grandfathering it in and providing a period of time for adjustment, we've also introduced a means test and introduced contribution levels, whilst we've also increased the amount of level of funding for students who may want to access specialized funding at low interest rates, moratorium on repayment, etc., for their tertiary education. So with that as a background, I'd also like to state that when you look internationally, I've heard some complaints about what goes on in other jurisdictions around the world. When you look internationally at the states that are able to provide free tertiary education for all of their citizens who qualify, and you look at the tax band brackets on income tax in those states, they are very often upwards in excess of 40% income tax. So when you have your citizens contributing 40% and upwards in Scandinavian countries, you have up to 50, 55% income tax being applied, it allows your government a bigger pot of revenue with which to offer these services. In Trinidad and Tobago, we still have a fairly substantially low tax bracket of 25%. When we looked across the board, the task force looked across the world at other countries who have similar tax brackets. Canada is one that came into play with a tiered system hovering around a mean of about 25%. And in Canada, there's a contribution system towards tertiary education. In the United States of America, as I'm sure many are aware, students have to pay for their tertiary education. And very often you find students 5 and 10 years after achieving their degrees and working, they're still struggling to repay student loans. We in Trinidad and Tobago have been very fortunate not to be in that type of situation. So with all of that in mind, the government had mandated the task force to look at it, and the task force came up with a number of recommendations. I think it's important to note that from the inception of the GATE program in 2004, the government of Trinidad and Tobago has expended almost $6 billion. We've expended $5.8 billion in covering programs under this GATE program, in covering educational programs under the GATE program. To date, over 200,000 students have benefited from the GATE program. Currently, we have approximately 45,000 students participating annually. The GATE program was initially conceptualized to transform the landscape of Trinidad and Tobago and our citizenry, which we think has been achieved, because in 2002, there was only a tertiary participation rate in our citizens of 8%, and this climbed to over 65% by today's date, actually last year's date in 2015. So the current level of tertiary participation compares favorably with the rate for developed countries. Many governments in both developed and developing countries have found it necessary over the last decade to reduce public funding of the tertiary education due to constrained economic circumstances, which is what this government has found itself in. And I pause there to use the opportunity to also draw to your attention what you would have heard from us before. We came in September 2015 and found all of the overdraft facilities available to the government of Trinidad and Tobago almost as their maximum level limits. So therefore, immediately as a government, you come into a cash crunch at a time where we've seen in the latter part of 2015 and early 2016, the price of oil dropped to as low as $28 a barrel. As I've said before, we are the only country in the English-speaking Caribbean that currently provides tertiary-level tuition support to our citizens. Barbados did at one time, but cut it immediately and in one fell swoop in 2014. It's also important, if I may at this stage, to outline that in addition to GATE, the government of Trinidad and Tobago also provides 400 government scholarships a year. The government of Trinidad and Tobago is also the largest contributor to the revenue stream of the University of the West Indies. The government of Trinidad and Tobago pays completely for the University of Trinidad and Tobago and a number of other institutions. So education remains a critical focus of this PNM administration. Who is the administration that actually birthed the UTT and many of these other institutions? We have always focused on education, but we're in very different economic climate and circumstances right now. We also have in place the Higher Education Loan Program, HELP, Financial Assistance Studies Programs, FSAP. So to get, as you all are aware, to the specific decisions now that were taken by Cabinet yesterday. Effective in August 2016, students who are enrolled in various programs at an undergrad level will continue to get their full funding. The government recognized that students who are already in their programs and had already signed the contracts with the government, we took a decision to just continue to the end of their programs to allow them that funding period, because we thought that would be the fairest thing to do. On that note, when we have done a review of the contracts that every single GATE applicant and student has signed onto with the government of Trinidad and Tobago, we have seen that there's been a lack of enforcement. So over the last five-year period, these contracts have not been properly enforced. For example, one of the terms and conditions in a GATE contract is that once you've finished, you have a bonded period of time, not to the government of Trinidad and Tobago, but to the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. So we're educating students, providing you with undergrad and postgrad degrees for you to contribute to Trinidad and Tobago. And we found that persons who should have been working here for the next three-year period, if it's a three-year undergrad period, have not in fact been doing so. We as a government, protecting taxpayers' monies and also trying to stay true to the real policy of GATE, intend to begin enforcing the GATE contracts. You've benefited from a GATE contract, come and give your service back to the country. And the contract specifically says you don't have to be employed with the government once you're employed in Trinidad and Tobago, and that is approved. Students who are registered to begin programs in 2016 for the academic year 2016 to 2017, again to alleviate their concerns, their fears, and to allow them a period of time of adjustment, we will pay in full the next year of your education. But be prepared, from 2017-2018 academic year going forward, a means test will be applied to you. This means test, as you should now be aware, is where you have a student whose monthly household income is below $10,000, the government will continue to fund 100%. I pause at this point to say it was recommended to government that the monthly household income be $9,000. The government felt, well, hold on, let's round it off at $10,000. So the government did not accept the recommendation of go with a monthly household income of $9,000. We increased it to $10,000. Where there's a monthly household income above $10,000, students would be required to pay 25% of their academic tuition fees. Again, the recommendation to the cabinet was to go 2/3, 1/3, i.e. once you have a means test applicable and the student's household income crosses the amount, which we've put as a threshold of $10,000, they should pay a third. We as a government decided, no, let's take it at 25%. So again, that was a benefit. And then where the monthly household income is going to be above $30,000, students are required to pay 50% of their fees. I understand that if you use an average of what the tuition fees currently are, which is difficult because it would depend on what the course you're studying is, this 50% means an approximate $4,000 annually. So all you're being asked to do as a household and contributing to the, if your income is over $30,000 a month, you're being asked to contribute $4,000 over a space of 12 months for the beneficiary of the GATE program. Effective August 2017, which would be next year, funding for postgraduate degrees will be available only to students whose programs are in alignment with the country's developmental needs. This gives the government a year to ensure that we've aligned what we see as the necessary qualifications at a postgrad level for the benefit of Trinidad and Tobago, for it to be aligned. And we're saying that from next academic year, if you're going to pursuing postgrad degrees, we'll only pay 50%, which is the current rate of your postgrad amount, based on what the government's, the country's developmental needs are. Effective August 2017, only institutions and programs accredited by the Accreditation Council of Trinidad and Tobago, ACTT, will be funded. This is a very big point that we hope and we expect will cut out, eradicate waste and corruption. Because what we're saying to the various institutions that now offer programs, you have a year to get your house in order and to get accredited by the ACTT. Have your institution accredited, so we will make sure the ACTT will make sure they meet the requirements, and also the programs. So programs that are not accredited will no longer be funded by GATE. Effective August 2017, the technical and vocational educational training programs only for level 3 and above will be funded. Effective August 2016, students will be funded only for one undergraduate degree and one postgraduate degree. We have found instances of persons using the GATE program to get multiple undergraduate degrees and postgraduate degrees. Of course, every time they do that, what it means is somebody else who may have had the opportunity to get a postgrad or an undergrad degree as their first postgrad or undergrad degree may have been denied that opportunity. So again, we believe that would be an eradication of potential wastage, because of course the whole policy behind it is to allow you the opportunity to get one undergrad degree and one postgrad degree. What we're also doing is we're going to increase the ceiling limits to $35,000 annually for you to get loans through the HELP program. We see this as marrying with the means test, so it means we're also providing a methodology for you to be able to access cheaper rate, cheaper loans, and with a moratorium on repayment. And a ceiling for students at regional institutions will remain at $75,000 annually. Effective August 2016, so that's immediately, persons over the age of 50 shall no longer be eligible for GATE funding. Continuing students over the age of 50 who are already enrolled in undergraduate degrees will continue to fund you to the end of your program. Again, I pause there. Another recommendation of the task force was that persons over the age of 25 be automatically mandated to contribute. We as a government took a decision not to accept that recommendation, recognizing that young people may have been working and then entered into their tertiary education at a later stage, and we want you to focus on being able to complete your education, and we're not going to ask you to pay automatic contribution on the basis that you're over the age 25. Effective August 2017, students enrolled in non-medical programs at regional campuses of the University of the West Indies that are offered at the University of the West Indies St. Augustine campus shall only be funded the equivalent level of funding that is available for you if you are at the St. Augustine campus. Effective August 2016, which is immediately, the government has taken a decision to discontinue funding of new students in the medical program at St. George's University, Grenada. We expect that to cut out a lot of money. Other decisions that Cabinet took are to boost and to provide additional resources to the Funding and Grants Administrative Division of the Ministry of Education, who will now be applying and implementing these means tests. And we're telling them they have to be very rigorous in their analysis of the means tests, again, to eradicate potential corruption and wastage. GOAT is also giving active consideration to education saving bonds, because we see this as a potential way for families to invest for the students of the future. And we're also thinking about establishing a national education savings fund. This is something I became aware of from North American countries. So for example, a child is born, you can open an account, put a certain amount of money in it, and every month you contribute to it. And the rate of interest and return is expected with your principal that when the child turns 18 years old, you will now have a fund that can educate your son or daughter, your nephew, whoever you've opened the account for, through their tertiary education. We're also considering fiscal incentives to encourage insurance companies and credit unions to invest in the development of similar education savings products. We expect that with the implementation of what I've just outlined, we expect a savings of $100 million within the first year. We're going to continue to try and push the savings to hopefully $200 million in the next year, continue along that line. I can tell you at our cabinet meeting yesterday, the recommendations that were made of the task force would have dropped the GATE funding to about $300 million for this year, somewhere about $350 million, down from $700 million. The cabinet took a decision to say no. We're going to invest $500 million in the continued next academic year, $500 million towards GATE. So whilst there are going to be some savings, we thought it important to still find $500 million to ensure that the GATE program in alignment with the other decisions we've made remains available for the students of Trinidad and Tobago. I think it's very important that the citizens understand the economic circumstances that we're dealing with. And even in light of these economic circumstances and the many recommendations that were made by the task force, to whom we'd like to offer our thanks for the work that they did in a fairly short time frame, we as a government still took decisions not to go with a wholesale adoption of all of their recommendations, with the benefit being to the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago and those who will continue to access the GATE program. The only way that the country will be able to progress and progress in a proper manner is if we all take some level of sacrifice going forward. And we think we've provided a very, very, very soft landing for the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago with respect to GATE, and we will continue to work. And as the minister said yesterday, all of this is not written in stone and in concrete. If things improve as we go along, the government will review the decisions we've taken. And likewise, if things deteriorate, we will be forced in the future, depending on the level of deterioration in our financial situation, which we hope will not come to pass, to once again assess the GATE program and the decisions we've taken. So those are the main decisions, or the decisions we've taken, and in a contextual background of why we've taken it. And also I've taken the time to point out very carefully the comparative analysis of what applies in other like sovereign states, and also importantly to set out that the government is committed to the continuation of tertiary education for our citizens in Trinidad and Tobago. I'd like to invite at this stage some questions.
Yes, Minister. Continuing on this particular topic, three things. Could you specifically say exactly how the government intends to enforce the GATE contract, as you alluded to earlier? What specific ways or strategies does it intend to do that? And secondly, has there been any analysis as to the numbers of persons who would be affected by the projected increased tuition that they'll have to pay from 2017? And thirdly, given that you said a little while ago that the government has received comments so far that the decisions have been taken on mature and responsible, how does that square to the claims from the opposition that the initiatives are discriminatory, they'll create poverty, they'll cause institutions to close down? How do you
All right, let me start, hopefully as I recall it, so you'll remind me if I forget anything. The first point is, at this stage, it is very difficult to see, projecting into the next academic year, how these decisions will affect the number of students who may or may not take up the opportunities to go along with GATE. That's for the academic year of 2017 into 2018, based on what we've outlined. Persons have to do an assessment. They have to do an assessment of how they will be able to afford it going forward. But we think by setting under $10,000, it allows those who may not be able to afford a tertiary education to continue having access to tertiary education. And we think that the means tests we've set have in fact found a very good average and balancing out of persons continuing to have the opportunity to access. And when you marry that with the increase in the availability of the loan amounts, etc., we don't see anybody who is serious about pursuing a tertiary education losing out on the opportunity. I could take this opportunity to also point out that one of the things that was found by the task force is the vast majority of persons who've accessed GATE in the past have actually come from middle to higher income brackets. All right, so you had persons who really could afford or had more affordability in pursuing these degrees as households, being the ones who are accessing the GATE program. You're going to have to remind me, Clint. Your first question was the enforcement. So the enforcement of the GATE strategy is a simple one. It's a contract. So what you now have to do is ensure that there's proper monitoring of the contractual terms. And once persons are coming to the end of their programs and the end of their degrees, what you do is ask them, okay, have you begun to make arrangements for your employment in Trinidad and Tobago? And those who don't, you give them a period of time, and this happens or is supposed to happen with our scholarship program. Those who don't, you then start off by telling them you're in breach of contract if you don't fulfill the contract and get a job working in Trinidad and Tobago or get an exemption from that provision, we will pursue you for the cost of your program. And you commence legal action in the worst case scenario. But we're hoping by signaling this at this stage, persons would become more aware that we intend to enforce your contractual arrangements. With respect to the opposition, I mean, I'm not going to spend too much time dealing with that. For them to say that this is going to bring about poverty, it makes absolutely no sense. I'll leave that for the right-thinking citizens of Trinidad and Tobago to figure out how they think this will bring about poverty. There is nobody who is going to be left out. There's nobody who has been told that you can't pursue it. What we've done is put in place a means test, and as I used the example before, a means and a contribution. The highest level of contribution, as I say, is 50% of your tuition fee. Let the opposition tell us what 50% of your tuition fee really means for household income of over $30,000 a month. Those who make under $10,000 a month, we will continue to pay 100%. How does poverty come into play? And what the opposition should really be answering to the country is when you're faced with a drop in your revenue of up to 60 and 70%, how is it expected that you continue to fund this? Isn't it more important that you ensure jobs are preserved and it's a balancing exercise of how money is spent? And there's been absolutely no critical analysis of this government in the first 10, 11 months of being in office of the expenditure of money.
Hi, Joe. What about those who might argue that investing in education is an investment in the future and that maybe instead of the decisions taken by the cabinet, maybe a more streamlining of the process, keeping the funding but making sure there is that level of accountability that you have just spoken of without necessarily making major cuts?
But Jula, do think they're major cuts. As I say, we have to deal with the reality of our financial circumstances. And we've set a means test. We've given people a year before this becomes applicable to take decisions. This government remains very, very committed to the provision, continued provision of tertiary education. When you do a comparative analysis, to example, the rest of our English-speaking Caribbean brothers and sisters. And you see the only other country offering it was Barbados. And they took a decision to immediately cut all funding in one fell swoop in a year compared to what we've done. We've taken a measured step back, limited scaling down, but an effective scaling down. And yes, we will be implementing and enforcing the proper analysis of the means test and how it is applicable. So we really don't see it as being anything negative at this stage, bearing in mind our economic circumstances. And it is finding a balance to continue the provision of tertiary education for all.
Do you have a timeline, Minister, for what you had mentioned earlier, that persons were benefiting from GATE, whose household income might have been higher than what might have been initially proposed for GATE? Did this start immediately after the program was launched by the first PNM administration that did it? Do you have a sense of when this started?
Well, I'm not following the question.
You said that there were persons benefiting from GATE.
Right.
High income or higher middle income. I'm just asking, do you have a sense of when this actually began?
No, I don't. The task force has told us that their analysis of it, so I guess it must be an analysis now, and them looking back over the last few years, they've found a predominance, and they've said that the majority of persons who are accessing it actually came from the middle and the higher income brackets. I don't have an exact figure and an exact amount.
How much of this is basically the responsibility of the state ensuring that such issues did not occur from the beginning of the program?
Well, understand at that stage there was no means test. So it was once you made an application and you were accepted into the program and then made an application to GATE and were accepted for GATE funding, it became open. But I'll tell you something. Last night I used the opportunity to address a number of students, a number of young persons and professionals, and one person who is an accounting officer at one of our universities locally applauded it. He said, "Mr. Young, I am happy that you all have done this because every year what I see is a recurrence of students who are not making the grades, or they come and they're changing their subjects, they're not finishing their degrees, etc. So immediately by saying you have to have one degree, we're only going to fund one undergraduate degree, you've cut out a whole set of waste, because apparently what was taking place is persons may start a degree, not complete the degree, then decide I'm going to change over. Now you're asking for a level personal accountability. Decide very carefully what is the one undergraduate degree you're going to pursue, and how can it be unreasonable to tell your citizens, I will fund you one undergraduate degree in these circumstances and one postgraduate degree."
A friend of mine I was speaking with last night was saying, well, okay, if the government, the state wants beneficiaries of GATE to work for insurance, be it any public or private sector as a way of giving back. Well, he said, okay, well, that'd be great, but where are the jobs?
And that's a good point, and that's why it's not limited to government alone. We hear constantly from the private sector, when I look at the newspapers on a daily basis, there are spreads every week of advertisements, vacancies, etc. Persons now must align their studies and what they intend to study with an eventual outcome of employment. So it is something that we're encouraging. It's something that we're hoping to find. But as I say, there are always exceptions. So the contract talks about exceptions. So if it is that you can, I assume if it is that you can show that you've been actively trying to get employment for whatever is degree and you haven't been able to do so within the time frame, I'm certain that a reasonable government would grant you an extension to continue trying to find that employment.
Good afternoon, Arvishi from CNC3. Minister, I'd like you to explain the means test. There's a lot of concern surrounding the actual test. You said that the Ministry of Education would be charged with conducting the test. Do they have the resources? One, what sort of questions would be asked? What's the criteria? Are you dependent on the applicants to submit information? Do I tell you how much I own? That kind of thing. And also, will it take into consideration persons who have 2 and 3 children probably would be accessing tertiary education at the same time?
Why we've given the space of a year before this becomes implementable or is going to be implemented is to work out the exact details. So for example, we do accept that with household, you have to define it very carefully. You might have a single parent household as opposed to a household where you have a grandfather, a grandmother, auntie, cousins, et cetera, and how do you calculate these exact specifics and particulars. So that is going to be worked out, and hopefully worked out within a short time frame. With respect to the application of the eventual definitions of the means test, yes, it is going to fall under the Ministry of Education. The Cabinet took a decision to reinforce and provide extra resources to the area of the Ministry of Education that would be required to do this. I have seen a draft means test form, which will include a statutory declaration by the applicant or not the beneficiary, but the person who is saying, I will provide X amount for the student. There's going to be a statutory declaration. So if it is found that you've not told the truth on that, the government is going to take steps. The government will take steps for prosecution of it. So it is going to be based on a number of particulars that have not as yet been worked out, but are going to be worked out in the same methodology that we as a government have been taking decisions. We're going to bear various things in mind, and as the Prime Minister himself said, in Jamaica and in Trinidad, we care, we are concerned, we recognize that young people need these opportunities, etc. So it is not our intention to put obstacles in the way and to make it difficult. It's our intention to provide a fair and equitable platform.
You did say that extra resources will be dedicated to the Ministry of Education. What does that cost?
Again, we don't have the exact costing as yet of how much that would be, how many more additional bodies, what extra equipment they may need, etc. So we've taken a decision, as Cabinet does at a policy level. This department will need extra resourcing because we're now calling upon them to apply a means test and to have various methodologies of assessing the information on the means test. So that will come in due course.
I think the question and the sentiment on the ground is that education has become more competitive, you would agree. Same a number of people accessing lesser funds from government. So in that becoming more competitive, they want to be assured that they will be adjudged for the funding based on, I guess, the economics, as you said, and also
Well, the only way you would be able to get into the program is you would have to qualify for the program. So if you don't have the grades to get into medicine, the grades to get into engineering, the grades to get into journalism, that takes care of that. So your intelligence must continue to be a part of it because it would that whatever course you're looking to pursue would be dependent upon your grades, and that somehow is linked to your intelligence.
Well, Minister, to be honest, there's a sentiment on the ground about the perception of government offices, how things are done, bureaucracy, all of that. People want to be sure that access and gates is not based on somebody that you know at the ministry, but really based on need.
Merit.
Yeah, merit.
Certainly that would be my position, and I think that's his government's position. We do not encourage in any manner whatsoever unnecessary bureaucracy or specific choice and analysis of anything as to who can come into the program of anything other than a fair and equitable system.
I've heard you talk about the country's developmental needs. What are the country's developmental needs? Education is streamlined, people informed, who are going to choose subjects, they want to know what to choose from now.
Agreed, and that continues to change. For example, when I was in school, you say here, many moons ago, unfortunately, you say here that actuarial science, there are only a couple actuaries in Trinidad and Tobago. That has changed. In my time and prior to my time, geology, getting into oil and gas, those things change. So it's always evolving. And we as a government have to do an assessment and see where the needs need to be. We have three hospitals that are coming on stream, Coover, Rima Point, Fortin. You're going to need nurses, you're going to need doctors, you're going to need medical attendants, etc.
So when is that going to be formalized?
It has to be formalized. I would, as I stated last night in another forum, I would expect that to be formalized by the first quarter of next year.
Okay, final question. How much will the task force
pay? I don't have any information to that effect. I'm not sure whether they were paid or not. A lot of times when we ask persons to assist, it's my understanding that they aren't, and I don't have those figures, if it even applies.
Good afternoon, Minister. Peter
afternoon.
Christopher from CNMG. I just have a question concerning the accreditation process for institutions. What would that process entail, and what changes would some of those institutions have to partake and to be approved for GATE?
I am not aware of the exact specifics, but from my understanding of the discussions we were having yesterday, for example, the accreditation of the programs, there would have to be programs being offered by universities and institutions away that are credible universities and institutions. With respect to the accreditation of your institution, there's certain, my understanding is there's certain minimum criteria that they must meet, a certain number of lecturers, provision of classrooms, etc.
Minister Ray Davis, Power 102.1 FM. Has the government determined whether this task force report is to be made public? Also, in the context of what you mentioned about students at the St. George's University in Grenada, what kind of feedback do you expect from Grenada itself in the context of its university not being considered as, you know, at least relevant to the GATE funding? Those two questions immediately.
All right, with respect to the Grenada, my understanding and to my recollection, GATE may have been funding maybe 40 to 60 students there a year. So that is just, we're not going to be funding them anymore. Scholarships may still go there. There are other means and methods of going there, etc. But ultimately, we as a government of Trinidad and Tobago did what we thought was right for Trinidad and Tobago and the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. And remind me, the first part of your question was
the government determined whether the task force report on
would be made public. No, we haven't discussed that or made any determination with respect to it.
Of course, the other questions relative are not connected to the GATE issue.
You all have a few more minutes, so go ahead.
the question of that fish kill and the oil spill affecting the Fullerton region. What has been the taking of that and that? Also,
one at a time. So with respect to the fish kill, what we've seen is that the bodies charged with the responsibility of investigating it have been conducting their investigations. We've heard recently that the Minister of Agriculture, under whose portfolio this comes, has stated that there'll be no compensation to the fishermen for this fish kill, etc. I think I saw that in the media recently.
Oil spill that has turned up at the Fullerton area in CGS.
That is, when did that? I am not in possession of the information with respect to that.
You will come to know, Minister.
I'm sure I will.
You will. In the context of the police, this issue of the police commissioner, I know it's a matter for the police service.
What issue with the police commissioner?
Well, of course, we have been hearing that the acting commissioner of police, Mr. Stephen Williams, has gone on leave and that there's someone else.
Correct. Well, I think it's all out in the public domain. Mr. Williams's last acting stint as per the police service commission came to an end on the 31st of July, which has passed. He has proceeded. He has quite a substantial amount of leave saved up and built up, and he's proceeded on 3 months of that leave. In the meantime, we have an acting commissioner of police in the form of Mr. Harold Phillips.
Right, and there seems to be some concern from Beetham residents with respect to a stench that has been polluting the air within recent times. And certainly, given what has been happening, has government been aware of this?
I am sure that the minister or ministers under whose portfolio that falls would be aware of it, but it has not come up for cabinet discussion.
And lastly, any quick update on Minister of Finance, Colin Imbert's road trip?
It remains the same. I mean, it was very successful. In fact, this morning, one of the things we did is I signed the Attorney General's opinion as the acting Attorney General, and that was to ensure, amongst all of the other documentation, legal documentation that had been approved, that we would have access to the funds. And that has gone very smooth and very well.
Two quick questions, Minister. Firstly, has Cabinet been updated at all regarding those 9 persons who were detained in southern Turkey recently? Because up to now, there has been no official confirmation as to whether they are our citizens or are not and what is going to happen to them. That's the first thing. And secondly, as my colleague to my right raised the issue of leave, did the Prime Minister leave any specific instructions with the government before he proceeded on his week's leave?
All right, let's start, and you've put the right proviso. Let's start with this. With respect to the reports of some of our citizens being held in Turkey, I think at this stage, we're still awaiting official confirmation from the Turkish government as to the exact circumstances within which persons were detained. We do have confirmation that, yes, some of our citizens or persons who appear to be our citizens were detained, but the exact circumstances within which they were detained, we have not received official confirmation with respect to that as yet. This morning, I'm happy to report that the acting Prime Minister, Minister of Finance, Colm Imbert, the Minister of National Security, the Minister of Foreign and CARICOM Affairs, and myself saw the Prime Minister off. And yes, as is normal when we meet just before he leaves, we had a number of discussions pertaining to the governance of Trinidad and Tobago, certain things that have happened and we would like to happen, and certain discussions and decisions, which I'm not at liberty to get into any particularization. In this day and age, everybody is accessible. I can tell you, yes, the Prime Minister, whenever he's away, remains constantly accessible.
Any update, Minister, on the legislation with regard to giving effect to that law passed in the United States
that has
to be passed by September 30th to avoid 30% of U.S. income being seized by U.S. banks?
Absolutely.
So that's cutting off ties with local
Correct. Banks. The answer is yes. We as a government have done all that we have to do. So there are two parts of it, the signing and execution of an intergovernmental agreement, which the Minister of Finance has been given the green light to go ahead and do, and then the laying and passing of legislation. That legislation requires a special majority. The legislation is ready and shall be laid in time when Parliament reopens. And it really is going to come down to what position the opposition takes with respect to it. But I think as the world recognizes, as our financial sector recognizes, as every citizen of Trinidad and Tobago recognizes, it would be a great travesty if the opposition does not support that legislation, which is really an international or an American requirement that will then lead to effects on all of us, me, you, and every other citizen of Trinidad and Tobago who wants to conduct business with banks in the United States. So we are ready. Everything is in place. We expect it to go as planned. And when we get to Parliament, we will certainly be doing what is necessary.
Does the government plan to reach out to the opposition, get some sort of consensus, either before the Parliament begins or before the debate begins?
I would expect so. As a responsible government, we will have conversation with the opposition. But let me tell you all something. This is an obligation that was in existence since 2010. In 2010, there was a different government and administration in place all the way to 2015. This didn't just happen from September 2015. So they were aware. All of the conversations we have had, for example, with the banking sector have informed us that since 2012, they were engaged in conversation with the then administration, up to 2014, providing support for the drafting of legislation, etc. So this is something that the opposition, when they were in government, very, very familiar with, very, very aware. Quite frankly, there's no reason why it shouldn't be supported. Last couple questions. I think what I my recollection is eight, possibly nine. Last question.
Minister, certainly we are winding down towards the end of our fiscal year, and certainly it has been a trying year that has been going by. What could we possibly expect, you know, in terms of, yes, what will be presented?
In the budget?
Yeah.
Let's wait for the budget or a little closer to the budget.
Not far away.
We aren't.
Right. In terms of the Jamaica situation, our Prime Minister's visit and you yourself and other staff having gone there, what has been anything that has been positive out of it at this time?
We continue to be in discussion. Up to yesterday, I was receiving correspondence from my counterparts in the government of Jamaica. We're working on a number of initiatives, items. We are encouraging our local sector to continue in commerce with them and to have open communication with Jamaica. Everything seems to be on stream, and we're building on the relationship now in a most positive manner going forward. All right. I'd like to thank you all very much once again for your participation. And I would like to take this opportunity to wish our Olympic athletes representing Trinidad and Tobago, all of the very best, and I hope we'll be celebrating in the next couple weeks some medals from our Olympic athletes. So as a nation, let's join together and wish them all the best, say some special prayers for them, and I wish them the best success in Rio as they continue to carry the flag very high for Trinidad and Tobago. Thank you all very much.